I've always had the confidence that I was a good race driver and that I could win. You know, I could drive, I could do it. But if I didn't have racing, if today racing was over with, yeah, I'd have some regrets because I hadn't won the Daytona 500. Yeah, I'd have some regrets because I couldn't race anymore, because I'd miss it. That's one of my big worries right now is, what am I going to do the day I quit racing? So I want to race as long as I can and get the fulfillment and get everything I can out of it.
Simply NASCAR's biggest star. He was NASCAR. Dale had it all. Love, fame, money. But no one could confuse that with ease. He had worked for every fan. Every dollar, every win. And for two decades, he had worked to win on NASCAR's biggest stage, the Daytona 500. NASCAR's greatest driver couldn't win the great American race. It wasn't that he lost, Daytona beat him. Back in 1998, Dale was trying for the 20th time.
This one is a little bit different, Alan. You just sense it in the garage area. The adrenaline's a little bit higher. There's so much more at stake. Will Earnhardt finally win a 500?
The man has just accomplished everything there is to be accomplished in this business, except win its biggest race.
It's not just that Dale Earnhardt hasn't won this race. It's how close he's come, how many times.
19 years of telling you how you can lose that race and what you can do not to win that race. You don't know why you can't win the most important race in history.
Now they're saying Earnhardt may have to come in for gas.
Well, here comes Benny Parsons. They slowed down so much that Benny, well, not that Benny isn't running that well, but, you know, they're holding him up now. The leaders are.
I wouldn't want a lap car in there.
There's Earnhardt's crew standing out ready to come in. And Earnhardt coming is coming in. Absolutely out of gas. The white flag coming down to Dale Earnhardt.
One lap to go. Does anybody have anything left with the man in black? Four-car shootout to decide it all. Dale Earnhardt.
Here comes Dale coming down on the inside. Earnhardt has
Earnhardt slumping back. Something does amiss. Here comes the field driving for the finish. The outside, it is car number 10, Derek Cope, something to miss on the Earnhardt car, coming to the line, it's Labonte pulling up, and an amazing finish, the Whitcomb Racing Team has won it.
Unbelievable. Looking like Earnhardt had a tire go down, maybe as he went into the turn. Gordon making a move on the inside of Earnhardt. Oh, Jared Cope's.
Down the back straightaway. Big trouble. Earnhardt out. And for the 19th time, Lady Luck deals a bad hand to Earnhardt.
Going there in the 20th year, it felt good from the first time on the racetrack. It just seemed like that this was going to be it. Saturday afternoon, our last practice,
right, she did.
Little girl, 8 years old, she's in a wheelchair, and she gave me a penny, and she said, Dale, this is your good luck penny, and you're going to win the race.
Thank you. It's a help to win the race, son.
And I don't know, something about that felt good. We took that penny and we glued it on the dashboard, and it just felt like it was our day.
What are you thinking about?
And to start the 50th anniversary season of NASCAR, the 40th Daytona 500 is underway.
To understand Dale, you have to understand where he came from. Kannapolis, North Carolina, in the 1950s, was a textile town. Fieldcrest Cannon, Plant 1, biggest mill in the world. Three shifts sweating out their lives in a fog of cotton lint. The Earnhardts couldn't live like that. Mom, Dad, and five kids. Two sisters, two brothers, with Dale in the middle.
I grew up in a racing family. I was really fortunate to grow up in a family I did.
My dad was my hero and the one I patterned myself after.
Ralph Earnhardt quit the mill to race on short tracks across the Carolinas. A good night meant $100 and not too much red dirt on your car.
Come out of the house in the morning, my dad had been going racing on a Saturday night, and I'd come out on a Sunday morning. I could walk around his race car and about tell where he finished by the dirt on the car, whether there's a lot on the front or if there's not much on the front. If he's not much on the front, he probably won.
Growing up with Dad as a racer is all we knew. Other families were unusual to us because the racing was our life.
And we didn't know any different. I mean, I don't know of anything that I lacked for, you know.
Dale learned bench racing. It's when Daddy was sitting in the shop. Dad would take a piece of chalk and draw the racetrack out on the floor. And he would show him, you know, where to enter, where to brake, where to get back on it. And Dale always paid attention to that.
I stood on a truck or on a tire and went around and around every lap with my dad, and more or less raced every lap with him. I watched him so many laps that when I got in a race car, I felt like I knew how to drive. I felt like I had what it took.
He said, Mom, I wish I didn't have to do nothing but just get in that race car and drive it. He just did not want to go to school. He wanted to work on race cars and mess with cars.
First thing in my mind was, I'm quitting school. I'm working on race cars. And I did. He wasn't happy about that, but I did.
He said, boy, if you just get your high school education, I'll buy you a brand new car tomorrow. I'll buy you a brand new car. If I just finished school for that, man, I'd been all right. I regret that more than anything in my life.
Ralph could have put him in a car, but he wouldn't put him in a car. If he wanted to drive, he had to go out and find his own ride.
If he had learned one thing from watching his dad, it was that no one would give him anything. You had to race for it. If he won, Dale would make his daddy proud. But he never got that chance.
When he first died, I was mad for several years about it. I was upset and mad about it. I just didn't even think about it. Didn't even want to think about it. But as I started in racing, I got thinking about a lot of things he did and how he was successful on the racetrack. I patterned myself after the way he drove, I reckon.
When Dale started racing, regardless of what level or how much money he had, our family was sustained. You know, our life was going on because the doors were up at the shop. And so it's almost like Dale moved right into Daddy's shoes.
Yeah, that's the way I felt about it. Like having a second father.
In fact, he was a father, married at 18. The family would find out on Sunday morning whether Dale had won or lost, whether there'd be money to pay the bills.
He paid the price two times by having two wives and then becoming divorced. Racing was his mistress. That's all he cared about. Whatever it cost, when being able to buy soap and toothpaste was a luxury.
I was in pretty bad shape. I didn't know I was. I thought I was in pretty good shape, but I'd go in dead a little bit every race. I came from the hard-working side of the track type racing. Get out there and work on the car all week, go to the racetrack and race, you know, on Friday or Saturday night, and work all day the next day and go race the next night.
It was life in the red. Red clay dust of the small town tracks where his daddy had raced.
We used to go up sometimes on Thursday, and he would practice a few laps. And he put me in there, and I sat in the floor. He said, I'm gonna head straight for the wall. He was headed straight for the third turn wall. And when we got right on it, he made a left turn. That's a rush. And I believe every time Dale Earnhardt got in a race car, he got that same rush.
Well, I mean, when I saw Dale, I thought, man, who's this hoodlum? He had on a dirty old t-shirt, and you know how he had that mustache and hair. I mean, he was a mess. Dale wanted to be somebody. He wanted to be somebody. I can't tell you how many times he said, I just need somebody to give me a chance. And I gave him a chance. As we got to be friends and as we got to know each other, I had a late model sportsman car then, a Busch car. He wanted to drive. He took my nice brand new late model sportsman car to Nashville and proceeded to make everybody over there very angry. He didn't win the race. He tore the car up. He ran into everything over there but the pace car. He brought my car back and I walked in the shop and it looked like it had been a demolition derby. He was a chunk of coal. We all figured he'd be a diamond someday, but it was going to take a lot of polishing.
He strived and he worked so hard and ran so well at Daytona and never had that Daytona 500 victory. That always really, you know, worked on him.
In the late 70s, winning the Daytona 500 wasn't yet the goal. The goal was just racing in it. Dale got his shot at the big leagues with Osterlin Racing, a team like himself, young and hungry.
I cut my teeth in racing around and with Dale.
You know, went from having my own race car the year before to having six race cars sitting ready and waiting. It was a daydream come true.
And he took off and it was like, wow, you know, who's this guy?
Now there's the kid to watch. This kid Earnhardt, the Osterlin number two, the car out of California, the driver from North Carolina, second generation driver, his father, one of the most famous short track drivers in American racing history, the well-known Ralph Earnhardt.
Time when you saw him come by, he's all leaned over and he's got that thing digging coming out of the corner. We spent a lot of time together. We would jump in the boat after a race and we'd go water skiing. Me driving the boat and Dale's back on the tube saying, come on, you can't knock me off. that was our time to get away.
Dale got his first win, then won Rookie of the Year. And in 1980, just his second season, he was champion of NASCAR. Dale was 29. For the first time in his life, he was a winner.
You know, I felt more accepted from the fans and from the racing fraternity, I think, after we won the championship together that year.
Race fans found a hero. This cowboy wasn't perfect or untouchable. He was one of them.
If there was a John Wayne in racing, it was certainly Dale and his father before him. Dale Earnhardt was a real man. Men looked up to him. Women wanted to be with him. He was incredibly sexy because he had just a swagger to himself that you never saw anybody carry themselves in that same manner in the garage. You know, he just exuded confidence and sex appeal because he was a man's man.
We were at Wrangler searching for a NASCAR relationship, and in particular a driver that fit the image of Wrangler jeans, the NASCAR equivalent of the Great American Cowboy, and we found him right away in Dale. He was robust, down to earth, honest, and he fit right in with our advertising campaign at that time called One Tough Customer. Use of that term was made evidently clear to me after a very bad wreck that he went through in Pocono, I think the 82 season. Simply demolished. He walked out of that wreck with a limp, and there was much speculation that he might have been hurt. I got a call that night from one of the team members. Dale broke his leg. I said, my goodness. He said, don't worry. He's having it operated on tomorrow, but you can't tell anybody because he doesn't want anybody to know, because if NASCAR finds out, they probably won't let him race. I don't know when NASCAR ever found out that his leg was broke, but he sure enough raced the next week. And he was one tough customer.
Something that without having a Daytona 500 to his portfolio as a winner, and as many times that he had came close, it wouldn't have been fair.
Richard Childress is an image of NASCAR success, but his early career and life was a mirror image of Dale's.
We both lost our dads at a young age. I lost my dad at a younger age. We both worked really hard as kids coming up.
Now there's so much that time and memory fade away. We got our own roads to ride. stood side by side.
We'd lay around down there in the hunting camps in South Carolina and talk about what we wanted to do, what we wanted to accomplish someday, and how we wanted to get together.
We'd always be blood brothers.
Childress had the car, Earnhardt had the talent. A friendship turned into a partnership.
We just let him drive. He's driving as hard as he can right now, I'm sure.
One lap to go at 200 miles an hour. All of these cars contesting for the lead. Earnhardt closes ground. He's going to try the high side. Earnhardt going to turn three at 200 miles an hour. Winds it up. Fires it in there. And it's Earnhardt going in front. Baker to second. Labonte back to third. A brilliant maneuver by Earnhardt as they come out of the tri-oval headed for the line. Who will be second? The checkered flag belongs today to the Richard Childress Group. Dale Earnhardt's crowd on pit road, ecstatic. So that's the story of the 1984 Talladega 500.
Won a race, did pretty good in 84, our first year. Second year, I think we lost like 11 or 12 engines.
And now we see a plume of smoke coming out from the right rear of the Dale Earnhardt automobile. And then it's never, of course, a good sign.
I said, Dale, you need to go somewhere else. I said, you need to go drive for somebody else. You're too good a race driver to sit here. And he just looked over at me and said, look, we did this thing together. We got in it together, and we're going to finish it together. Rest of it's history.
Everything ran right once the boys at Childress Racing got just as wild as their driver. Sixteen wins in just 2 years. Championships in 86 and 87. This was something beyond success.
See this guy hit? Huh? 6 foot six, 280 pounds. You think Ernie Elliott's gonna match him?
You see back there? Ed Miller. He's so bad we got him chained.
Come on, get in here, Chuck.
You can't give chocolate a bell.
We are ready.
Ready?
What else? You want some of that?
Come and get it.
We all, you know, I like to tell everybody, we didn't like each other, we all loved each other, and it kind of grew, and we had the same group of people for a long time.
We were kind of like the fans in the stands. We'd sit there and watch with amazement at the things he would do, just like the people in the grandstands were doing.
We're racing at Richmond, and it's back in the old Richmond track, and he's got the car is totally covered in mud. And he hollers on the radio, Richard, I need to pit. And Richard says, Dale, I hate to come in and pit and lose all that track position. And Dale comes on the radio and says, I'm going to be off the radio for a few minutes. And then you see Dale come riding by, driving with his knee and got one head, and he's cleaning the windshield off.
He was teaching us stuff, and we didn't even know it, about driving and being able to accomplish your goals.
A ride that began on worn down dirt tracks had become a path paved in gold.
We're going to see this next year.
And throughout this journey, one woman was by his side.
I met my wife, Teresa. Her father raced Hal Houston, so she's been in racing for a long time, around racing.
Yeah, I did grow up in racing, and I understand that life. I've always been around it, so it was very natural for me.
She's been with me since 1978 in racing, and she was with me when I was a rookie and decided to get married in 82, and been the best thing that ever happened. Wish I'd have married her in 78.
He was definitely always driven. But he had to sacrifice relationships to get to where he was. There's a lot of pressure in racing. It gets very intense. And if you don't understand that, you don't have a chance at a relationship. It definitely was a joint partnership.
I was really lucky when I lucked up on Teresa, and she came along and helped me handle my business side, and she's been the lawyer in the family, so to speak.
I don't know. I think our relationship must have been so different from normal people's because we put our personal relationship before business. And I think that's probably why it worked so well, is because we knew we always came first. You have to know, you know, when to chill, when to shut up, when to not. The longer that you're with someone, the more comfortable you get, and you really know if you want to be there or not. What a lot of people have said is that he would do whatever it took and that he didn't care about anything but racing. That's not true. He cared about a lot of other things but racing, but he would do whatever it took to get the job done.
Family moved to the forefront of Dale's life when he gained full custody of the children from his second marriage.
My mom really couldn't, her only means was to go back to Virginia where she was from and live with her mother. You know, Dad had just come off the year winning the championship, and she thought that maybe he could provide a, you know, better means for us to live than she could at the time. So we moved in with him on the lake. And I just remember then we got to go to the store and pick out a black and white television for our rooms, and that was kind of, we didn't have TV in our rooms before that, so it was kind of cool.
Yeah. One of the things I remember us doing a lot was going riding on the pontoon, you know, just going for a ride. He always tried to get everybody together and go for boat rides and just cruise around.
Get a little better. Miller
tore my butt up.
That thing is rough, ain't it?
Yeah.
No, we went to a lot of races as kids.
Yeah, I went as much as I could go.
Yeah.
And you begged to go every week. I pulled for Daddy, and I wanted him to win.
Dylan Hart after he just won the Die Hard 500.
What's the question, dude?
How was the race?
Well, it was hot, but it was fast.
Yeah?
Just like you told me to go.
Yeah. Did you draft a lot?
Yeah, I drafted just like you told me to before the race.
You didn't have to pass too many, did you?
Well, yeah, we had to race them pretty good there and watch our gas mileage there at the end, but we did exactly what you told us and we won the race.
Are you going to give me some money when you get home?
I doubt it. You spent enough down here this week.
Oh, okay.
Often, Dale Jr. had to admire his hero from afar.
He had so much on his mind, it was really hard to get him to yourself.
Yeah.
felt like if I was around it and got the camaraderie of the guys and felt like one of the guys, that Dad might include me more often. Victory Lane enhanced all my daydreams about my future. You know, I always daydreamed about driving and winning and, you know, the things that I wanted to do and accomplish. Just dreaming of the day I was going to win races.
Would you like to have a career in racing? And if so, what would you like to do, Dale?
Well, I want to be a race car driver someday. It's a great sport. I love it to death. You know, it's all I've ever known, racing.
Earnhardt has Bobby Labonte with him. Earnhardt, number three. Labonte in 18, and they draw a bean on the Ford Taurus. Mark Martin, number six. 50 years of NASCAR racing, 40 Daytona 500s, and perhaps never one as much in doubt as to the outcome of this one. 15 laps to have won.
That's the Super Bowl of stock car racing. And it wasn't going to be right. His career wasn't going to be right or complete until he won that race. And I had a front row seat for a lot of that disappointment.
And as the man in black goes out for more practice here at Martinsville, our time is up. Thanks for watching this edition of Inside Winston Cup Racing.
Back then, in the mid-80s, there weren't a lot of TV cameras around the sport. And for whatever reason, I got along with him pretty well. And two big things about him, it was trust and respect. If he trusted you and he respected you, he would essentially do whatever you wanted to do.
Is it rolling?
We are. Smoking grass.
Right.
It's a lot different atmosphere than the racetrack. He would test you. He would definitely test you.
Fans would think, well, if he's run that many laps, he'd already have the track figured out. What does a team learn when you come to a track like this?
By what?
This is going to be a long one.
Okay, here we go. Now, what? Since you've run so many laps here, what do you...
How many laps?
Over 10,000. I figured it out.
10,000?
Nah. At least.
There's two sides to it. One was the 8-year-old. He'd try to bump the cameraman into somebody else and mess them up. We were doing a shoot on Lake Norman, and he had this deal with a bass boat company. And I was sitting on the bow of the boat, on this little tiny seat, holding on to the seat in my left hand, camera in the right hand, and he had his hat pulled down in his eyes, and he had the throttle down as fast as it would go. Well, all of a sudden, I just felt this thump. And I shot straight out of the seat, the camera went up, and all I could think was, oh my God, this expensive camera's gonna go in the lake and I'm responsible for it. So I jumped up. As I jumped up, he pulled the throttle back, and I caught it with my elbow, and as it came down, it hit me in a place where it hurts to be hit. And he started laughing. He said, you had a wreck.
Thanks.
He did things like that all the time. I was on a shoot one time at his farm. He had a bulldozer, and he absolutely loved the bulldozer. He would just ride around and knock trees down. And I was shooting a ways back. And all of a sudden, I realized this tree is headed right for me. I thought, I'm just gonna have to stand there and take this. And that tree came down, wham! The tip of that tree brushed against me, and he's in the cab of the bulldozer just laughing his head off. And he'd always have that mischievous grin. You know, he'd always give you that half smile. He would get right to the edge of hurting you, but he knew not to. But if you hung in there with him and proved that you weren't intimidated by him, he was great to be around. In there pretty low, didn't you? And this is where his famous line, I'll never forget, he looked at me and he said, pays more to win.
You know, I didn't try to wreck, didn't run him in the wall or nothing. Then he tried to wreck me after the caution there. I think he's a little upset.
He did things on the racetrack that other guys would only think about. If he saw a hole, he went. While other guys may have thought, is this a good time to make the pass? He made the pass.
Earnhardt just drives around in the dirt.
Goes through the dirt.
When you get your front end in there, and the guy tries to cut you off, or he tries to do what he can to keep you back there, you stand your ground. And a lot of times it comes out bad, but a lot of times you win races too.
Certainly if you asked Darrell Waltrip, he would say he was too aggressive.
Everything was cool until we started to compete against each other. And when you start to compete against even your best friend or even your brother, sometimes it brings out the worst in a relationship. I was on top, Dale wanted to be on top. I had everything that Dale wanted, and Dale was going to take it away from me. You know, we just started really as a friendly rivalry, and it grew out of that, really. It was kind of harmless, but once he got into Cup, and once he started to have some success, then it turned into, at times, just really ugly.
They may get together, right? Anytime the next couple of laps, like how about right now? Earnhardt on the outside, Waltrip in the number 11 on the inside.
Dale and I were having one of those, Dale and Darrell duels. It's getting late, there's only 10 or 15 laps to go.
There's where you want to make your move into. Hello. I'm here, I just wanted to let you know, in case you're dozing, that I'm around.
Keeps chopping me off, blocking me, I can't get by him.
There he is on the inside. He's down there. Earnhardt, cuts him off.
So I gave him a shot, and he got all loose, and I got a little run on him. I thought, dadgummit, he cut me off again.
Nobody's got anything coming right now. Oh, they get sideways.
He hit him coming off, and he hit him going in.
And I get him sideways, and I think I got him this time. No, couldn't get him.
And Darrell Waltrip may have it. He's along. He cannot make it.
So I go down into turn one. I drop my left sides off in the dirt. I go in there as hard as I can. Body slam into Earnhardt and shoot him up to racetrack, and I got him this time.
Now Waltrip on the inside. Side by side.
Well, we get off of turn two, and he gave me a shot.
Oh!
There you go.
And when he did, it took us both out.
Darrell Waltrip's alongside of him.
There's the hook. Bang.
Earnhardt came down, caught the right rear of Darrell's car.
Car torn all to pieces, disintegrated. He spun too. Cars wrecking everywhere.
A disappointed, discouraged Waltrip trying to gather himself up, climbing out. Thought he was going to victory lane.
Just hung up with old Darrell. We got in the wall.
that could have hurt me. And I know Dale wouldn't intentionally do it, but he also was, he could be really ruthless. And that day, he was pretty ruthless.
Dale wasn't racing to make friends. Friends got in the way. Friends would have to be a sacrifice.
It's hard to have a friendship in racing and be consistently friends. There's always been a fear inside me of not having a ride. People would think after championships that you would be comfortable with your ride. Yeah, I've always worried about not making it or losing it, not having it. That is a thought to worry.
The threat in the rearview mirror has changed from blue and gold to black.
The nickname Intimidator just came along. I reckon that's because I drove a little aggressively back then. Get close enough to a guy to put that pressure on him, you make him crack. You can make him do things they don't want to do.
Three wide as Earnhardt begins to put the old Intimidator pressure on.
If you are a badass and you can back it up, it will intimidate people. The more successful that he was, the more fun that he actually had using the Intimidator persona. And being known as the Intimidator, he would put people in situations and they would not know if he was joking or not. Just to see how far he could take it.
Man, y'all should have done been set up. I can't wait on this setup.
I will say this, Dale could look at people, and just by looking at someone, Dale could make them doubt themselves.
Yeah, you can use a little psychology on people. Well, that's the way you win championships, is to consistently keep the pressure on.
I'm a hard-working man.
Aces, and you're about to see why. David Smith on Jack. Chocolate Myers tosses that empty gas can. Bobby Moody will in. Slug nuts down. He goes. He's gone.
Come Friday night, I like to party more.
The 90s brought four more championships in 5 years, including the magical seventh to reach Richard Petty's unreachable record. Carolina kid had become his generation's greatest racer.
Them guys put me in position to win. Without that, I couldn't have won. So it's teamwork. I guarantee it's teamwork. And there's not a day or a race that goes by that I think I'm doing it by myself. And when I start saying I did this and I did that, I hope Richard Childress shoves his fist in my mouth.
The bond and the trust that we built in each other is we would tell each other like it was. And I can think back, we never had a big disagreement about anything.
Now there's so much that time.
Oh, God.
Time and memory fade away. Got our own wounds to ride. And chances we gotta take.
We could lean on each other no matter what the situation was.
We play king of the mountain.
We were climbing a mountain over in New Mexico.
Welcome charging up the hill.
That day, for some reason, Dale's horse got to slipping on rock and it started flipping back over. Here the horse come flipping down the mountain. He and I fell off the mountain together. Dale thought it killed me and the horse. I remember we got back at camp that night. I said, if it would have killed me today on that mountain and I wouldn't have made it, I said, you know you'd have had to go and race, don't you? And he said, yep, same here. So I've always remembered that story.
And we said until we died, we'd always be blood brothers.
Daytona International Speedway, the biggest race of NASCAR, the Daytona 500. 96, 97, and 98 are three of the four laps of this race that Earnhardt has never led. The other is lap 200. Trying though, every lap he goes upside, Rusty Wallace. He goes downside.
Well, that'll work right now, but I wouldn't want to do that to Earnhardt with 10 laps to go, I can tell you that.
It was the holy grail. You say, yeah, but 7-time Winston Cup champ, and people say, yeah, but Daytona 500. I decided that my son needed to see a super speedway. I went down to Talladega. I got media clearance to go down among the transporters. I found Dale's transporter. My son gathered up all his courage and said, Mr. Earnhardt, can I go touch your car? And Dale, instant grin, said, not only that, I'll make you a deal. I need you to touch my car today because it's going to bring me good luck. And if I win, I want you to come down and join me in victory lane. So Dale moves through the crowd, and my son pressed his little palm against this black number three. We said our goodbyes. Earnhardt pulls off this spectacular Talladega win.
Earnhardt, here comes Jared. Here comes Burton. Earnhardt walks away. And Dale Earnhardt will win the Winston 500. Let the celebrations begin.
There we are. The champagne is just starting. I move my son up. Before we know it, Dale's lifting my son over the car. My son's lifting the Lucite trophy, which Dale had to help him with. It was really the first real live action superhero my son had gotten to know. But you know what, for that matter, it was the first one I'd ever gotten to know too. If you're out there working for a living with your hands, boy, this was your guy. It was kind of like, of the 43 cars out there, that black one with the three on it really was running for you. The guy who's working on ball joints and front ends all week in the shop, who takes his family out and saves for it, that's who he wanted to race for. He represented blue-collar hopes and dreams in this country.
He represented us.
And that's, I guess, the best way you could say it. He was me.
He was my idol. I don't care what he did. He was my idol.
He did what all of us dream of doing.
He was grassroots. He was right there just like us in the ditches, working on his farm.
I drove race cars for a living.
It meant a lot to him that he was from that class in society. He would never betray that class in society.
We've got a new road race car we're building. This is the road race seat I'm fixing.
I've done them all ever since I started racing. Jake Ellers told me, he said, if you're going to drive it, you're going to fix the seat. I don't want to hear you grumble about the seat not fitting. Good time.
Just like he was one of us. He never forgot that. He never got out here and said, well, I'm Dale Earnhardt. Get out of my face, I ain't signed no autographs, you know. He never forgot where he came from.
Well, I'm still Dale Earnhardt. I can win a race on Sunday, and I can feed the cows on Monday and collect eggs at the chicken house or whatever. It doesn't matter to me. Because we win doesn't change my attitude or my way of life. I do a variety of things on the farm. Do them myself. I'm a jack of all trades and the master of none.
Welcome to my office. I'm glad y'all could be here. This is where I work every day.
When you talk about doing a job, I mean, there's nobody in the world could think about doing something that I enjoy more than racing.
You see me driving a race car and I'm running up front or racing somebody, I'm doing what I really, truly enjoy and I feel comfortable doing, and I'm at my highest.
Dale's greatest thrills came at the highest speeds when his skills moved beyond the wheel and into thin air. Guiding his car into slipstreams that few others could find, the explanation was simple, if not mystical. He could see the air.
They claim I can see air, but it's really air that's coming off the car, and I understand where it's at or should be. I anticipate it as much as I can see it.
Daytona 500. Dale Earnhardt's been coming here for 20 years trying to win this race.
I tell you, with the luck that Dale Earnhardt had here in Daytona for the 500, a creak in the back of that car would sound like a cowbell to him. I guarantee you, he's sitting there wondering, is something else going to happen to me?
Earnhardt has lost this race every which way you can, and usually in the closing laps.
Just how many heartbreaks that he had just chokes me up even thinking about it, because I knew in his heart how much it meant to him to win that race.
Dale Earnhardt Incorporated was built in 1998. Now a team owner, Dale wanted to take a chance on an unknown driver, just as someone took a chance on him.
He left a message on my answer machine, and I just kind of erased it. Thought it was friends of mine kidding around. There was a message like, how come you don't call me back? I'm called you twice now, you know? And I said, oh my God, that's Dale Earnhardt. When I first moved down here, I actually lived at Dale's house. Well, I couldn't sleep the first couple nights because I'd lay in bed and I'm thinking, well, I'm in the Intimidator's house, and he's just like right upstairs, and I was just kind of petrified about that a little bit. And then, you know, he'd wake up at 4:30 in the morning, and he'd come down, and he would kick into my bed and be like, all right, Park, get up. You know, and I'd get up, and it'd be dark out. And he's like, come on, we're going to go down the farm. There was nothing on his side of the truck. Like, if he wanted to show you something, it was always like, look at them deer over there.
There's a turkey. Something.
That's my cow over there, you know? He hit you in the chest again and point.
She's sort of hanging there. The gobbler should be here somewhere.
You know, that's his cow. There's nothing ever on his side of the truck. He's never like, hey, look over here. I'd have him drop me off at the shop, and I was like, whew. Now I can work on the race cars. You know, but you look back on it now and you say, what great times. My rookie year, punctured a tire, it's in the car, hardened to the wall. And I ended up with a broken leg, fractured clavicle, just numerous injuries.
He is out of the car, on the stretcher. He is conscious, and they are going to load him into the ambulance.
Dale needed a driver. An old rival needed a break. Nearly 25 years after borrowing Darrell Waldrop's car at Nashville, Dale returned the favor.
Sure enough, Dale called me up, and he said, I'll never forget, he said, I need your help. And I thought that was pretty cool.
Darrell Waldrop is really a reborn race driver since getting with Dale Earnhardt. All he's got to do is focus on driving. And look how well Darrell Waldrop is running. Look at him go.
That was one of the best times of my whole career. Dale and I got to spend so much time together. We mend a lot of fences, healed a lot of old wounds. It really kind of brought us full circle. We started off needing each other and kind of working together and helping each other, and ended up doing that very same thing. And that was pretty special.
Really showed the loyalty that he had. I mean, I don't think you see that in many teams anymore. You felt like you were family.
He was a mentor and a dad, and he tried to show me the right way about life.
At the age of 16, Dale's oldest child, Carrie, finally became a part of Dale's life.
We started doing a lot more things together than what we did in the past. He was trying to spend more time with the family.
In 1988, Dale's fourth child, Taylor Nicole, was born.
Come on, go get some.
Hey, giving that for me up for yogurt.
Turn around. That's right there.
Hey, Taylor.
Give me a kiss.
Give Daddy a kiss. Give me a kiss.
I love you.
I love you.
Every single day, every time he saw me, we'd always say, I love you. We'd hug each other. You see multiple pictures for race and stuff where I'd be kissing his cheek or whatever. We did that every single day. It was a very loving relationship.
Learn to be daddy again. Taylor, she's been a great addition to our family.
I enjoy having her and the family along with me as much as we were able.
He was like the ultimate dad. Like I was a daddy's girl. I'd go everywhere with him. He was my idol.
Well, I mean, when me and Kelly were born, he wasn't in no position to be a father. And then when Taylor was born, he had his life the way he wanted, I guess, to be able to do that type of thing.
Unfortunately, racing, you had to put a lot of stuff behind and sacrifice a lot to achieve a great amount in racing.
When we were younger, he was away from home all the time, and I felt maybe a little bit cheated. Now that I'm racing and involved in a lot of the things that he was doing when he started out, I kind of understand him more and where he was coming from before.
As Dale Jr. moved up the NASCAR ranks, that too was a family matter.
Well, you look like your tar.
He finally got a chance to live his racing dreams in a car owned by his father.
He's a teddy bear.
Nah, polar bear.
You're a teddy bear.
Polar bear.
You got a polar bear on your car, but you're a teddy bear.
Polar bears are a lot different than a teddy bear.
But the polar bear's on your car, Dale.
The polar bear's got the claws and you go to.
But you're a teddy bear in your seat.
That was awesome. I mean, that was really something I had a lot of fun with. I enjoyed a lot. You know, it sort of made up for a lot of lost time.
And we were at
Wow. Now, was that your dad or is that the car owner?
That's a car owner right there.
Is that your son or is that your driver?
That's the son. He's an awesome little driver.
Boy, could he be proud or what? What a moment for the family, the Earnhardt family.
I just sat down and wrote this little, about a page and a half about how I felt about him as a person. So I read it to him, and he was just really happy. You know, he was like, man, you know, we don't talk about how. He just stood up and he said, we don't talk about how we feel about each other enough. He said, you don't really tell me no more than I tell you. And for you to tell me that and read that really sets it in stone. I know exactly where you stand, and that means a lot to me. I read it often. I just like to remind myself of what he meant to me. Sometimes you need reminding.
Time's really short to spread between family, home, racing, the dealership, and then, you know, the farm. Try to have something for the future for, you know, the wife and the kids someday if something happens to me. Number three, head
head-on into the wall at 190 miles an hour.
He almost got upside down. That car got very high off the ground.
And they're gonna cut him out of the car.
And Earnhardt is on his feet. Dale Earnhardt attempting to walk to the ambulance. Never, never doubt that cliche about Dale Earnhardt, one tough customer. Gives the thumbs up as he walks away from one of the worst incidents in his racing career.
Next race was Indy, and I knew he couldn't run. We didn't want him to. Therese and I had told him not to run the race, but he wanted to start it for points.
Earnhardt wanted to start the race, would like to have run all day. The crew tried to convince him not to. They said he stayed up last night and watched Clint Eastwood movies, thinking he might change his mind and try to stay in the car. No, he's going to come out and get healed for next week at Watkins Glen.
And I never will forget the look on Dale's face that day he got out of that car. It's like it had that empty, lost look. It's the first time anyone had ever gotten in one of his cars, I think.
Dadgum, it's hard to get out of there, Jerry. It's my life right here.
Boy, an emotional Dale Earnhardt. You will never see that. This man loves and lives to race.
For nearly 2 years, Dale didn't win. His body ached. Another man had driven his car. For the first time, Dale questioned his abilities.
He said, maybe it's me. He says, maybe I need to get out of a car. And I told him, I said, Dale, it's not you. You haven't lost nothing. You're as good as you ever have been. And he said, I'm going to make you a better race driver this year. He says, I'm going to win the Daytona 500.
From the hard working side of the track.
He fed his family by winning.
I said, Earnhardt, you ran her down in there pretty low, didn't you? And he said, pays more to win.
He became an American legend.
He was the first superhero I'd ever gotten to know.
Now, only one film has captured what it was like to know him.
I can win a race on Sunday and I can feed the cows on Monday.
Chevy and Goodwrench bring you an encore presentation of the motion picture Dale tomorrow at 8, 7 Central, only on CMT. Pick up the soundtrack from CMT's new motion picture, Dale, featuring Lynyrd Skynyrd, Travis Tritt, Brooks and Dunn, and introducing Brent Keith. Available now at Walmart.
Working 172 laps, 430 miles complete. The story is Earnhardt striving, struggling to finally win this 500.
28 laps to go. Eight times in 19 years, Dale Earnhardt has been in this position at this juncture of the race, in the lead. Four times with the triple backstretch. One car, two cars go sliding down the back straight away, and we are under caution.
So that takes all that pit strategy away.
Pit road will be the center of action as Dale Earnhardt leads Jeremy Mayfield, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Gordon, and every one of those 17 cars on the lead lap.
Earnhardt coming down pit road for what will be his final pit stop if all goes well. The plan, take two tires. That's what Rusty Wallace's plan is as well.
Earnhardt has the quick pit stop. It'll be Earnhardt leading the charge off pit. Times at this point in the race, with 20 laps to go, Earnhardt has been the leader. He still has yet to find the key to the gate in the Daytona 500. It's been 59 races since Earnhardt has had a victory. They're not going to wait for one to go. Seven laps to go. Here comes Mayfield right up against the bumper of Earnhardt again.
Whoa.
Just like you do up here in the broadcasting booth.
There's a slow car up ahead.
And there's trouble coming off of turn two. Some cars get trailed and might be this. Whoever gets back to the start finish line, they'll get the five and the yellow together. This could be the Daytona 500. Bobby Labonte goes to the outside.
Labonte up high. Earnhardt uses the last car of Rick Bass as a pick. 20 years of trying, 20 years of frustration. Dale Earnhardt will come to the caution flag to win the Daytona 500. Every man on every crew has come out to the edge of pit lane to congratulate the man who has dominated everything there is to win in this sport, except this race, until today.
That trophy right there, my name's on it now. They can't take it off. My car's going in Daytona, USA. I don't care. I love it. I want it to be there. It took me a little spin in the grass so I'd get the good out of it.
To win it in the 20th year, your 20th try, 50th anniversary of NASCAR, to finally win the Daytona 500 made it all complete.
Racing's been great. It's been, you know, it's pretty neat to do something you thoroughly enjoy. You look forward to getting up every day to go do and to make a living, make money at it too, and be able to have the things you've got, we've got from it. So I got my cake and I can eat it too. It's pretty neat.
My dad would be proud of what we've accomplished in my career as a racer, but I also think he'd be proud of our family. I've gotten to a point in my life to where I really enjoy a lot of things, and I can enjoy a lot of things, but I still like getting in a race car and racing and winning.
Okay, DW, we're rolling. And when we get to 10 minutes, I'm
going to
go like this.
Okay? 10 minutes? Man, we can't do this in 10 minutes.
Okay.
How do you feel about Dale Earnhardt?
A lot better.
I've known you
a lot better today than I did several years ago because of family, because of my life, because I think I'm a better person than I used to be. I got a great wife, a great family. Proud of my kids, all of them. I've really got it all right now. I got it all right now, Darrell. I got it all.
No, you really do.
I'm a lucky man. I have it all.
Getting set for the start of the Daytona 500. Whose face will grace victory lane today? Earnhardt to the inside on Wallace.
He's got some push from behind, so there's a good chance he's going to get right up on the Sterling before they get to the end of the back straightaway.
Number 24 on the bottom side, and here comes Michael Waltrip up the middle.
Hey, we hadn't talked about Uncle Mike all day, and there he is. Come on.
Get a little bit of help from Steve Park, his teammate. Steve goes back behind Gordon, going to the bottom side, three wide through the trial.
Racing like it's the last lap, and there's still 35 to go.
Up there in the lead. I guess it's right behind him.
The owner, Dale Earnhardt Inc.
Wonder what Teresa Earnhardt's thinking right now. She's got a team she owns. Dale Earnhardt Jr. and her husband out there running 1-2-3 right now.
It's the big one. It's what we've all been fearing. This kind of racing is going to happen.
A horrible crash on the back straightaway that began when Tony Stewart got turned sideways against the backstretch wall number 20.
God help all of them, because there's no place to go.
And it looks like everybody's going to walk away from this crash unscathed.
Here they come, gang. I told you, you think these guys would settle down, take it easy, say, hey, everybody's going to get a good finish? No way. They're going to race their hearts out.
Three wide into turn one again.
Let me tell you, that's the best thing that Mikey's got going for him is those two cars behind him. You got to pass two cars to get to him. I believe Dale Jr. and Dale Sr. both are doing all they can to help Michael make that happen.
Oh! Earnhardt. Sterling got into Earnhardt.
Dale is doing everything he can to keep Sterling behind him, because Dale knows that Sterling's got a fast car.
We're coming around with a white flag.
You got him, Mikey. You got him, man. You got him. Come on, man.
Come on, baby. Come on. Get him in the four.
Get him in the three car, guys.
Oh! Big trouble. Oh. Big wreck behind him.
Lead him back. Come on.
To the flag.
Come on, Mikey. You got it, man. You got it. You got it. You got it. You got it. He's all right, isn't he? As soon as the cars cross the line and I kind of get my composure, I look up there and I see Dale's car sitting in the third turn. I got a lump in my throat. I knew right then that something bad was wrong.
I put my headset back on and I said, Dale, are you okay? Dale, are you okay?
You okay? You okay?
I mean, I was at my grandmother's watching the race when the accident happened, and because we weren't there, we had no idea what was going on, what people were saying, and what was happening.
Saw the crash and saw the cars sitting over there and saw the ambulances and everything, and it looked really dramatized and really dramatic looking, you know, and it just looked odd.
Yeah, I think everybody were expected him to walk away from the crash like he always had. I really didn't expect him. I mean, that was just really unexpected.
This is undoubtedly one of the toughest announcements that I've ever personally had to make. But after the accident in turn four at the end of the Daytona 500, we've lost Dale Earnhardt.
I can't believe it.
We're now faced with one of the most difficult moments in the sport's history. So you had to force yourself to go on professionally.
And when they were celebrating that night, I can tell you that, you know. And so it was the whole sport suffered on that, you know.
He wasn't just one of the drivers who won a lot. He was, he's part of the family.
You know, the worst part, I think, was like when they put his face on there on television and you'd see 1951-2001, and that was just when it hit, and you knew that it wasn't no dream.
It was amazing that the fans were as close as they were. You know, they come out to DEI and just hung out for a couple of days and just, you know, mourned with us and, you know, grieved with us.
When he was killed, it was like a piece of me, a piece of Bobby, hit the wall at the same time. We lost something.
He's a hero. Heroes don't die.
You not only have the emotion of losing your best friend and your hero, but what are we going to do? What's going to happen?
I made up my mind I was going to quit racing. I was going to come back and get out of it. You know, that's what I wanted to do. Go back to my conversation on the mountain that day. We knew that wasn't what Dale would have wanted. And I said, we'll hit and paint the car white, find the next number available, and we'll stick out on the car.
Well, I don't know that I really had much choice. There's hundreds of people that compete for this company. Everybody had a job to do.
I got to Rockingham, cloudy, cold, rainy day. When I drove in the motor coach lot, where Dale's coach would normally be parked, was just flowers. It was just so sad.
Against the outside wall, and from the last lap of last Sunday to the first lap of this.
This cannot be happening to that young man.
Deciding to race Rockingham, we got to do what he would want us to do and go out and win races. The last five laps, I started thinking, we're in a position to win this race. I was emotionally falling apart in the car.
Here we go.
And finally, a voice came over my shoulder and said, suck it up, boy. Get it done. Go win this damn race.
One lap to go. This is it. Park
wiggled and got into Labonte. All right, Bobby's off early. He's off early. He's going to gas it hard. And here they're going to come to the line. It's going to be a photo finish.
Park has the run off the high side. He clears Labonte. And Steve Park scores the second straight win for Earnhardt Incorporated.
Boy, and that team, that company, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, they needed that.
Everything happens for a reason. I think that was the beginning of all of us knowing that life does go on.
Two weeks later in Atlanta, the healing continued. Others found inspiration in Dale's absence, his son still struggled. For 5 months, Dale Jr. quietly carried his pain, then laid it down at the doorstep of where it all began.
The fact that my father lost his life there makes it a special place. That corner in that racetrack, that's a part of my life. My father was in the same situation. I mean, he lost his father at about the same age.
Six laps to go. Earnhardt Jr. lying back, trying to get him a run. Pass him on the strict play racetrack is a tough thing to do.
Jr. win this race.
Look at Jr. go!
Jr. second spot. Mayfield pushes him along in the draft. Dale Earnhardt Jr. goes for the lead. To the outside for the lead in turn four. Dale Earnhardt Jr. rushes to the front of Daytona. Listen to the crowd. Final lap at Daytona, 180,000 on their feet, screaming wildly.
Come on, man.
Here they come, turn four, final lap of the Pepsi 400. Dale Earnhardt Jr., using lessons learned from his father to go from sixth to first and score the victory of the Pepsi 400.
The sport wasn't ready to lose Dale Earnhardt. There's just a void there.
There's not a day goes by that I don't think about him, and I certainly don't ever walk into a racetrack without thinking about him.
Doesn't seem like it was that long ago, but it's like days are going by like pages in a book. I mean, it's been a while now, and we still think about him a lot.
I have dreams about Dale. Sometimes they're good, Sometimes they're bad. But I still have a hard time thinking that he's not going to walk up and ask me what the heck am I doing.
Miss a lot of things about Dale, but one of the things I really missed was he'd call me at least once a week at home at night or something, and he'd say, finished that glass of wine yet? I said, no. He said, well, grab it and come over. He said, sit down, let's talk a while. He was a special friend. He would be one that I could count on my one hand.
It just amazes me how many people love my son. They always will, I think.
That's something I think about with my children is I want my daughters to understand how caring he was to people, how giving he was, how talented he was as a race car driver, you know, but I want them to know the person that he was as well.
That comes along once every 50 to 100 years where you get a guy like that, and just like when I go read that thing I wrote, I hope everybody is still fresh on their mind of how good he was and how tough it is to stand up and stack up next to him.
Dale's death is very, very sad, but it's not a tragedy because he died doing what he loved doing.
This is a guy who died knowing what was important in life. He always said, if I died doing this, I died happy. Don't mourn for me, but so much.
It's an American dream from a pair of faded high water blue jeans, metal dirty t-shirt, and to see him step out on stage in New York in the Waldorf. That's a long road.
It's a road that millions have dreamed of traveling. Thanks to Dale Earnhardt, they did. If only for a few hours every Sunday afternoon.
It's been said before, heroes never die, and that's true. He'll always be with me, and he'll always be with the world.
Heroes, are there any really heroes in the world?